morning, everyone. Welcome to church. Is anyone ready to praise God in this place this morning? Come on, hands together.
With all I have. Oh,
I love standing in the community of believers, singing with one voice to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. How great thou art! Come on! What a mighty God we serve, amen? Amen. I'm believing for God to do something supernatural in this service today. Are you believing for that? You didn't come in here just to get out of the sun, to soak up the air conditioning, but to have an encounter with God, amen? Amen. I've got a whole bunch of prayer requests here, and I don't know if you were here last Sunday night, but we were able to highlight some of the impact of what happens through Hillsong Television. And every week when we stand up here with praise reports and prayer requests, there's a whole stack of them from TV and a whole stack of them from within the service. And so I want to really encourage you. We're going to pray. We're going to believe for God to do something supernatural in these lives. So there's a whole list up there on the screen of things we're praying for. Why don't you grab a hold of one of those things in your heart, you get in your spirit, and why don't you start to pray? Come on, why don't you start to pray? Let's pray, church. Lord, we believe for breakthrough. God, we believe for you to have your way. Lord, we pray for your turnaround anointing, God. We pray, Lord, that today we would see breakthrough in situations and circumstance. Lord, we believe for salvation, for restoration, for your healing power to be at work in the lives of people. Lord, I pray for people who are believing for your provision, Lord, and for breakthrough in that area of their life. Lord, have your way, we pray. Help people, we pray. Lord, I pray that you would move by your mighty Spirit today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Oh, you're singing and you're praying like you really mean it. I just wanted to just tell you about a couple of good reports that came in. Someone here, you know, it's so easy, you can read three words and say they're saying, thank God for the adoption. I mean, I don't know. I know that's a long process. And for us to be able to get to the end of it and praise God with you, I'm praising God. That's awesome, hey? Someone else saying last week they put in a prayer request to get a job. They finished work on Friday after 3 years. On Monday, they went job hunting. On noon, they got a response. On Tuesday, they got an interview. Wednesday, they started their new job, and they're thankful for your prayers. How cool is that? And people praising God for all sorts of things. Someone else thanking God that their son got home safely. Why don't you turn to the person next to you and say good day. Before you sit down, grab this newspaper off your seat. Has everyone got their newspaper? Their Christmas newspaper? All right, let's just, I want to take you on a little tour guide through our Christmas newspaper. This is, I love it. Our guys work really hard to put this stuff together, and we drop this in mailboxes in all your neighbours, all your family, your friends. So hopefully it helps you to, you know, have another thing to talk to someone about. But there's a whole bunch of things that we really want to just make sure that as the church we're aware of and we're highlighting. On we have the Christmas Community Festival, and this is on page, actually there's no page numbers, so you're going to have to dig a little bit. Sunday the 21st. We're having the Christmas Community Festival, and the Sunday the 14th we're having the Christmas Spectacular, and the spectacular is the 21st as well. So we're taking the London West End Christmas production. So it's not going to be like anything you've seen before here. It's going to be brand new and high end. So we're doing it in our Hills campus because we've got all the, you know, the production and lighting and sound and everything to make sure it's awesome. So people from other campuses are going to come and grab tickets. So you want to make sure you beat them. Because those Southwest people, I mean, they take up a lot of tickets. You want to make sure you're ready for that. So you can grab tickets in the foyer or online. You guys are all talking to each other. That's good. I mean, it's Christmas spirit. It's just, the other thing I wanted to tell you about is the Stuff the Bus campaign. And we talk about it, I guess, as a campaign, but you know, this is something that we as a church see as a real ministry to the cities that we are in. And we work with partners
to make sure that we distribute these gifts. So the whole idea is, and you'll find it in here, you bring a gift and we give that gift to some of the most needy families in our country. And so we work with some of the coalface organisations as well as through our own City Care. And we give, in one instance, one organisation we work with is Prison Fellowship. And I love this one because we give them gifts to give on behalf of their parents who are either in jail or not have a capacity to be able to give gifts to their kids. So as a church, we give tens of thousands of items to this program every year, and it really does make a difference in the lives of people. I mean, I thank God that we are, you know, blessed as we are, but what a great thing it is for us to take ownership of the people in our community who need it most and do something about that. So, and the other thing about in this newspaper that you'll see is the Christmas lights. So do you remember last year we lit up this whole property with Christmas lights? Well, you ain't seen nothing yet. I mean, this is a whole nother level. So next Sunday night. Now, why do we light the property up with Christmas lights? So that the community feels like they can come onto the property, engage with the people of our church, be welcome to come to church and be a part of it. So it's really just about making room for more people in the house. But next Sunday night, we're going to launch the lights and we're going to, you know, Pastor Brian will be flicking the switch. It's like his dream every year. He just lies awake just dreaming about flicking the switch to the Christmas lights. It's going to be awesome. And one more thing, which isn't in the Christmas newspaper, but I wanted to tell you about anyway, is this Tuesday night at 7 p.m., Sisterhood United Nights. Come on. We have a rowdy response from the first 5 rows. In the chapel service, it was just the first 2 rows, so we're getting better. Hopefully, at 11 a.m. when I say we have a Sisterhood United night, we'll go all the way to the back on the floor of excitement. Oh, I'll tell you what, they're going to have to work hard. But I want to tell you, it's the launch of the colour invitation. So it's a really special night for Pastor Bobbie, and she would love to have. We copied your idea and we had a men's event, and it was awesome. I think we copied it and we took it like one notch higher. So the challenge is out there, girls. Let's see what you can do on Tuesday night. It's going to be awesome. All right, I'm going to ask Robert Ferguson to come and talk to us about our tithes and offerings this morning. Why don't you welcome Robert?
Thank you, Darren. You are a good man. Hello, wonderful people. How are you doing? Well, this is our opportunity to do good. This is our opportunity to make a difference. We're going to come around our giving right now. Maybe you're new to the church and you're not sure how you can give. You can check out the screens or you can look at the back of the blue envelopes. If you're a visitor, of course, absolutely no obligation at all. But if you make this church your home, this is our opportunity. I just want to thank you for your generosity and your commitment just as you get ready to give. I was speaking at a Business Connect this week and I was just overwhelmed again by the faithfulness of the people of God. People have been in the church 5, 10, 15, 20 years, consistently sowing into the kingdom to make a difference. You know, Galatians chapter 6 talks about sowing and reaping. And as a former farmer, I can say there are 3 principles to sowing. There is priority, consistency, and longevity. Priority, you give your best. Consistency, you keep giving your best. And longevity, you think about the long term. And that's what people have done over the years in this house, and I just want to thank you. At the end of that chapter in Galatians 6, it says this, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest. So may I just encourage you, for those of you who have been faithfully giving, don't give up. Why don't we take those gifts in our hands and let me pray for you and let's believe that God's hand of favor will be on us at this season. Father God, thank you for these amazing people, their contribution, their consistency, their generosity. I pray, Father, that your hand of favor will be on this house and on the individuals in it. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen, amen, and amen. Well, just as we receive that giving, loads coming up, as Daz has said, why don't we check out church news?
in silence. Have we forgotten the simple, the eternal conversation between Creator and creation? We are drawn by a whisper, so that we might hear and retune the senses as He waits for our response. Speak, I'm listening. Speak, we're listening.
Plenty of good things coming up. We wanted to take a minute and welcome all of our campers, which have linked to us now and our live stream. We have a special moment that we want to kind of bring to you guys. So it's going to be introduced via video, and then I'm going to come back and talk to you about it. So why don't you watch the screens and let's check that out. Hey church, welcome to Compassion Weekend. As a church, we've been working with Compassion and partnering with them for over 15 years, and we've seen over 37,000 children sponsored. And when we sponsor people on this weekend, we're focusing on one region that we've been working on for years. It's the Kasese region in Uganda. The whole idea is if we can change a community, a village, then we can potentially change a region, and then over time, who knows, we could change a whole country. And we've been able to see thousands of children sponsored in 12 projects in this region. And some of the stories that are coming out of this partnership are phenomenal.
We've been sponsoring Compassion Children for probably almost 30 years. We first had one Compassion Child, and then we thought, oh, we can manage this financially. Then we decided to take a second one. Well, the letters is what makes it personal, and even we've had a few children through Compassion that were still very young, and you get just a simple drawing and then maybe a few words from the teachers, and then gradually they start to write more in these letters.
I just felt the first photos of Olop, she was a very shy and timid. Yes. And she was in a really difficult time. The rebels killed quite a few of her family members in the village, and that was very hard for her, very emotional. We had lots of letters to each other and photos. And in the time we sponsored her, she became an orphan, her mother died. So we kept in contact, they call us mum and dad. And I've learned that over the years, that's what happens.
It's not about guilt. It's about grace. 25 years ago, when my Compassion sponsors went to a Compassion table and they picked up my packet, they were not just picking a packet, they were picking me. And I remember thinking, What if they didn't pick me? What if I wasn't there on that table? What life would I be living?
Our part was the financial, but we always prayed for her every day.
Through the example of Olive, we know that there is a ripple effect from that. And that gives us some comfort. I mean, it's uncomfortable that we can't help more people, and that, you know, the world is such a tough place for children, but at least compassion is doing its bit, and we're part of that. So it's a privilege.
I wanted to just take a moment and introduce you guys to Hans and Maria Shrew, and what an awesome thing for you guys to be long-term sponsors through Compassion. And we understand that you've been sponsoring through some of our conferences and events as well, and it's amazing. And we just wanted to give you a gift and just say thank you and honor you for the years and years of faithfulness. So why don't you guys just... As you can tell, we kind of tricked you guys into coming today and meeting Olive. And you just said to me, oh, have you seen Olive? I'm sorry, I had to tell you a little kind of lie that I hadn't. But it's an awesome thing to see your life grow, Olive, and to see you now represent Compassion as a spokesperson. And I wanted to just ask you one question, and, you know, I guess we just want to eavesdrop a little bit on you just being able to tell them the difference that it made, them being able to sponsor you. So, you okay?
I was 7 years old. My grandfather put me on a bus to go to the capital city, Kampala. When I got to the capital city, I was traumatized because for 2 years, we were running from place to place, hiding from the Lord's Resistance Army. And we went to a church and got registered into the Compassion program. I got my first letter, and it was from Mom and Dad. And the letter was, it's very nice to have you to look after. We loved you. We love children. I knew what love was. Mom, Dad, you have made me what I have become. You have taught me grace. And with that same grace, I extend it to other children as well. Because Christ showed you grace, gave you grace, and you extended that grace to me. And I'm very thankful for what I have become because of your selfless act of grace for me and other children. Thank you.
Amazing. Thanks, guys. Amazing. We'll give you guys some time alone so that sorry to make your first introduction in front of thousands and thousands of people, but we want it to be a fly on the wall. Why don't you take your seats for a second? Isn't that a phenomenal story? And, you know, I was talking about this in the 8 a.m. service and highlighting Compassion and just giving people an opportunity. If you don't sponsor a Compassion child, we would love to be able to help you with that. And I picked up Innocent Baluku, who was born on the 16th of July 2010, is from Uganda in the region that we work with. So we have a number of projects in that region. And so, Karen, we have a new member of our family. I just thought I'd share that in front of all these people. You okay with that? So, on the doors on the way out, there's going to be a whole bunch of people standing there with Compassion Children. We would love to ask you, you know, it makes a difference in the lives of these kids. It's not just helping them with their education or helping them with food. It's actually that love relationship that actually inspires them to be better people. So I really want to encourage you, if you have room in your house or if you can make room in your house, we would love to be able to help you to sponsor another Compassion Child, all right? Awesome. I held myself together. Are you ready for the word this morning? It is with great honor that I get the opportunity this morning to welcome to preach our senior pastor, Bobbie, who I am now going to call the bird whisperer after watching your Instagram yesterday, rescuing a baby kookaburra. And but honestly, what an awesome woman of God is that is leading us and taking the charge. And you've got no idea how much they lean and take the charge and the hits for us as a community. And I really want to encourage you, let's across all of our campuses, even if you're online, why don't we all be upstanding and welcome Pastor Bobbie as she comes and brings a word.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, church. Good morning. Are you well? Fantastic to see you and great to see you on all the locations. There's so many locations, actually. I don't know how many, I've lost count, 41 services and 24 locations. So yay, everybody here on this location, give everyone out there a hand. And so nice. Amen. Praise the Lord. And anyone else who is watching today as well, it's fantastic to have you with us at Hillsong Church. And yes, I have become the bird lady. I am. If you saw Instagram yesterday, it's like a giant baby kookaburra, naked, bald and enormous, fell from the sky. I'm like, right onto my balcony. And I'm like, is this a dragon? Anyway, we named him Carl, and it was a team effort. He's at the Sydney Animal Hospital. But the tragedy is, I opened the curtains this morning, and there was another one there. I was like, Carl had a brother, but I don't think he made it, all right? So, isn't that terrible? And I text my kids, and I went, Carl had a brother, but he's dead. And both Joel and Ben text back, and they went, what, Mum, what? Obviously, they haven't seen my timeline. I'm like, no, Carl's brother, Carl Lentz does not have a brother, and he's not dead. It's okay. So, you know, the lunacy of life. Nice to see you, Mark. Mark's home for a visit. Amen. And I love what happened with the children just then, because this is who we are and this is what it's about. And James says that true religion is to care for the orphan and the widow, for those impoverished and in need of help. And so I think some of the favour toward our church is because of the generous hearts of so many of you who sponsor and adopt thousands of children. So God bless you. Amen. Father, we just commit this day to you, and it's a beautiful day outside, Father. We pray for Brian. He's in India, Father, paying attention to what is in Mumbai with Vision Rescue. But Lord, we commit ourselves to you, and I pray, Lord, for every home and household, for every family, for every individual watching in this morning, that you will bless them, and that your word today, Father, will be strong and powerful and life-changing. It will go forth and accomplish what you have purposed and not return void. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Turn around, give someone a high five, and you can be seated. Amen. You know, I'm actually camping on this theme here today, as you can see on the screen, if my journey could teach you anything. And we've been doing a series that Sisterhood Could Brave. So I'm brave woman running my family, hallelujah, in the same way that brave men run in our family. But I'm just going to take a page or two out of some of the teaching that I've given in the last couple of weeks. But before I do, I just want to say pastorally, church, that, you know, I honestly believe that as a church, there is a new depth and a new stance within this house. Can anyone feel it? Yeah. I can feel it in the atmosphere. You can feel it in the worship. We were away recently. We came back, and it was like we walked in here, and we could sense a depth and a different stance in the spirit realm. And, you know, I believe that as a church, we've had an incredible year of favor. We are a church on fire, hallelujah, in so many ways and in so many aspects. We're a church on fire, but I also believe that we're a church that this year has been through the fire. On fire and through the fire. And you know, in February, we declared over this house at Vision Sunday, pioneer again, pioneer again. And you know what? You cannot declare that into the atmosphere. I mean, we're not a normal church. You cannot declare at a 30-year mark in the journey, let's pioneer again. You can't declare that without the natural and the spiritual stakes increasing. You just cannot do that. And so again, I believe that it has been a year of uncanny favor and grace and open doors, yet it has also been a year of refining for what lies ahead. And I want to say to us, as your pastor and your friend today, all campuses here, especially Hillsong Church watching in, do you know what? If this year you have felt the heat, if you have felt the heat or if you have felt the challenge, and I want to be careful here because in a church like this, it was so many people in attendance. Do you know what? There are families who this year you have suffered great loss. Great loss, and I'm not diminishing your great loss and your pain to mere heat or challenge. And I want to say to you that we love you and we stand with you and we believe that the saving and good grace of God will actually lift you up and beyond your grief, okay? But when it comes to heat and challenge, I just want to encourage you not to despair. It is just the refining and the pruning and the firing process for the wide open, expansive places that God is calling us all to, okay? And I believe, if my journey could teach you anything, it is that heightened calling often brings with it heightened territory or new territory that often attracts heightened aggravation from all that can oppose the call of God upon our lives, which is why, church, you know, the foundations of our lives need to strengthen. It's why the foundations of our lives, our faith, our thinking, our convictions need to strengthen and become shored up so that we can actually allow God to continue to build the building up and forward as He intended. And I'm talking in analogies here. I'm talking about us as a collective body and church called to do what we're called to do. But I'm also talking about every individual because, you know, we're not a church without all the individuals. And it's what God wants to do in your life. So apply it wherever you want to in Jesus' name. And I also believe that is why our Brian, you know, our pastor Brian has been teaching, I think, so apostolically. I mean, the man is like on fire, right? Can you believe that? He is like, seriously. I was telling him in the chapel that I said to him on Monday, I probably shouldn't tell you this, I looked at him and he kind of like, it was the first time he'd like stopped in literally weeks. And I went, so, sweetheart, you do realize that you've hardly engaged me at all. You've hardly talked to me at all for weeks. And, he, you know, typical male, he just looks up and kind of smirk, like. I'm like, no, I'm serious. Like, saying okay when I say, darling, dinner's ready, is not talking. And he kind of looked at me and I'm like, I'm not complaining. I've given you space. Miss No Maintenance here. I've given you some space, but I'm just pointing out. I shouldn't tell you that, should I? But oh, I just did. All right. But anyway, I believe that he's been preaching like a machine. Seriously. Because we need to see the foundations of our faith strengthen so that we can continue wherever this path is going to take us. And so I want to read to you from Proverbs chapter 5. And I've been camped around a little bit with the girls. It's a favorite. It says, my son, my daughter, be attentive to my wisdom. Godly wisdom learned by actual and costly experience. My son, pay attention to wisdom learned by actual and costly experience. It goes on and it says, incline your ear to my understanding Incline your ear of what is becoming and prudent for you, that you may exercise proper discrimination and discretion, and that your lips may guard and keep knowledge and the wise answer. So here is a very powerful exhortation to pay attention to wisdom that for the most part is learned through costly and actual experience, in order that we might live life with the right discretion and discrimination and discernment, and that we can bring a wise answer whenever we need to actually others, in Jesus' name. So this morning, three thoughts. If my little journey could teach us anything today, it would be three things, and I've just pulled three things from recent teaching at Sisterhood. Okay, so the first one, it's going to go on the screen. Number one, it says, if my journey could teach you anything, baby dolls, it would be no road, no journey. No road, I know it seems obvious, but no road, no journey. How many of you, excuse me, would agree that wisdom and truth are beautiful? On the page. They are beautiful. Grab your Bible if you have a paper Bible. All right, look at your phone if you don't. But you know what? How many would agree that this wisdom and truth, wisdom is beautiful. It's so beautiful on the page. We read it and it feeds our soul, and it's beautiful on the page. But you know what? It is learnt on the road. It is read, it is meditated, it is absorbed here, and it is learned on the road. Costly and actual experience. And you know what? If we never step out onto the road, it is unlikely that the journey actually will truly begin. And where are the lessons if we never step out into it? Where is the costly experience that comes with that territory? Psalm 84, I love always, speaks of hearts set on pilgrimage. Hearts set on pilgrimage. It speaks of hearts in whom are found highways to Zion. Highways. In your heart today, are there highways? Is there a highway to Zion? If we were to look at your heart, I'm talking figuratively, of course, but so then is the word to us. Are there highways within your heart? Let me read it to you from the actual psalm in the Amplified. Psalm 84, 4 starts. It says, blessed, blessed, happy, fortunate, and to be envied are those who dwell in your house and in your presence. That would be us, people. Because at Hillsong Church, we love to dwell in his house. And we love to dwell in his presence. We are the Psalm 92 people. Those who are planted in the house of God shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall be singing your praises. Yes, that is us also. Hallelujah. All the day long. Now, Selah, pause and calmly think of that. Blessed, happy, fortunate, to be envied is the man whose strength is in you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you. Let it sink in its magnitude here, in whose heart again are highways to Zion. Passing through the valley of weeping Baca, they make it a place of springs. Passing through the valley of weeping. Oh no, surely there's not valleys. Surely there's not like places of weeping and valleys and road bumps along this road. Yes, there are. But you know what? We don't count that we pass through them. And as we pass through them with a revelation of who his strength is, his strength in us, we turn those valleys of weeping into places of springs. Amen. The early rain also fills the pools with blessings. And verse 7, and they go from strength to strength, increasing in victorious power. You've heard me say this many times in our journey. They go from strength to strength, to strength, to strength, increasing in victorious power. I mean, is that our testimony? Is that your testimony? Is that the testimony of Hillsong Church, 31 years, that over the years with giants to slay and whatever to navigate, that we have gone from strength to strength to strength, 31 years together? What about you? I'm 42 years in this journey with Jesus. Can I testify today that I have, by the grace of God only, but by the grace of God, gone from strength to strength to strength to strength? How about you? I pray that that is your prevailing testimony. It goes on, I just puff myself out, just preaching. Verse 11. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. Beautiful. The Lord bestows, listen to it, present grace and favor and future glory, honor, splendor, heavenly bliss. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed, happy, fortunate, to be envied is the man who trusts in you. And I look at this compilation of words, leaning and believing in you and committing all and confidently looking to you, and that without fear or misgiving. I love the word of God. So church, again, no road, no journey. No road, no costly experience actually outworked in your life as a powerful testimony to others. So I want to say, my darling friends, do you know what? Don't fear the road. Don't fear or draw back from the road and what it might actually represent in your life. Commit to the path and stay the path. And it is never too late to start. It is never too late to get off the grandstand if you have suddenly found yourself on the sideline in the grandstand. It is never too late to suddenly go, you know what, like in Pilgrim's Progress, I have lost my sword. I have put down my sword. Where is my sword? Christian was on his pilgrimage in Pilgrim's Progress. Okay, it's a novel. But you know what? He was on his journey and he suddenly realized, I have lost my sword. I don't have my sword. And the instruction was, go back and pick up your sword. You cannot continue until you pick up your sword. And so again, it is never too late. And I want to say that this beautiful kingdom road will not disappoint, nor fail, nor destroy you, actually. And also in Pilgrim's Progress, there is a powerful line on the screens where it says, actually, the lions are chained. If you keep to the center of the path, they cannot touch you. Okay, so you know, yes, we worship the one who is called the Lion of Judah, and he is unfailing and he is all powerful. But you know what? There are lions and there are challenges and there are things that would seek to sabotage our path and our journey in life. But you know what? It's like it says, if you keep to the center of the path, if you stay in the center of his will, and you stay true and beautiful and pure, I promise you that they cannot touch you. Shut up, I love it. And you know what else? It is also never too late, church, to realize anew that we travel better together. Serious. And our experience and our stories are intrinsically woven together. And so, you know, into our Brave series with the girls, you know, Naomi and Ruth have been a perfect example of that. A perfect example. And there is no Ruth story without the Naomi story. There isn't. Do you know what? There is no Bobbie story without the Brian story. There is no Hillsong story without your story. Your story. There's not. And so, again, you know, this beautiful redemption plan, journey, story, it is seriously interwoven, it is completely interwoven with others, and it is this insane interconnective puzzle that is ever unfolding down through the decades. And our decisions and our choices and our example profoundly affect that, not only in our own lives, but in the lives of others. Absolutely. Through the decades. And you know, I was telling the girls, sometimes, you know, we just think in our time frame. We think, this is my time frame, my life, this is my time frame. And if it all doesn't turn out or, you know, unfold, then you know what, how unfair is that? But you know what, God works generationally. And should you actually live your life in a manner where you go up, not down, you will get to eternity one day and you will look back and go, oh my gosh, I sowed, I gave, I sacrificed, and maybe I didn't see the full breadth of the fruit in my lifetime, but God will get you up and above and go, but look, look at this decade, look at this generation, look at this nation or this continent that you made a difference in. So don't underestimate that, amen? Let me give you a very tiny snapshot from Naomi and Ruth's life. just four little thoughts, things that I saw. Firstly, they were on the road together. Their hearts were set and their hearts were knit together. Mother and daughter, it was a generational story. And what is so apparent is the great affection with which they traveled. And so in Ruth 1, when Naomi saw that Ruth had her heart set on going with her, there was another daughter-in-law who wanted to return. And so they kissed and they embraced with great affection and she returned to her homeland. But Ruth said, no, my heart is set on going with you. And when Naomi saw that, she gave in. And so the two of them traveled together to Bethlehem. Do you know one of the things I love about our church is the great affection that we have for one another? I mean, obviously we can't know every single person, but you know, if you are connected, you will do life with a realm of people within this house. And the affection and the camaraderie and the family, we're not just contacts doing life, we are family. And there is great affection and we should protect it and cherish it. Something else I saw, second I saw, there was a strong kingdom work ethic. A very strong kingdom work ethic. In Ruth 2:2 it says, and so one day Ruth, the Moabite foreigner, the foreigner, said to Naomi, I'm going to work. I'm going out to glean amongst the sheaves, following after some harvester, following after some harvester who will treat me kindly. She was a little bit clueless to what was about to happen. And you know, Naomi said to her, go ahead, dear daughter, go ahead. I love this. What I love here is that the daughter committed herself to the harvest. She committed herself to the work. I mean, Ruth wasn't content, the daughter, I'm talking generational principles here, the daughter wasn't content to ride on the sacrifice of Naomi. She had traveled with Naomi back to her homeland. Naomi was the star of the show, the town. Oh, Naomi has come back, woohoo! Okay, no, but Ruth wasn't content just to ride on the coattails of that. Content for Naomi to make all the sacrifice. She wasn't content to wait for Naomi to cut yet more ground and make more sacrifice and figure the future. She got into the labor. She got into the work. She committed herself. And the other thing I love is I love that the mother encouraged her daughter to do so. She said, go ahead, my dear daughter. Now, I'm taking license here, but she said, go ahead. Go ahead, dear daughter. You know what? Accomplish more. I'm not threatened by you. Now that's a beautiful, pure spirit, and it's not always been the testimony across the landscape of the church worldwide. This affection and this generosity and this lack of territorial whatever, it's powerful. The third thing I see in this little story is they chose the right field, they worked, and they followed in the wake of the harvesters. In Ruth 2, it reads, and so she set out. She went and she started gleaning in a field. She went and she started. I love that. Following in the wake of the harvesters. Eventually, she ended up in the part of the field owned by Boaz, which was the destiny connection. And again, I love that the daughter, young people today, young people listening in and watching, I love that she chose the good and the right field. And you know what? I love that she got, she just did that. And I want to encourage you that, you know, whatever field or career or path or road that you choose, because there's many ways that we can serve God in this 21st century. You know, it's ministry, yes, but it's career and business and arts, whatever it is that God calls you to, whatever field you choose, hallelujah, just make sure that it is attached to the kingdom field. Okay, so God had a specific for Ruth, but she landed in the right kingdom field, and with the passage of time, God maneuvered her to exactly the right place so she could collide with her unique destiny, amen? And I want to say that there is nothing wrong with ambition. Ambition is good, it is God-given, but ungodly ambition sometimes has you trying to cut your own wake. Cut your own path when God never intended. He intended you rather to get in the wake or the slipstream or the pathway of your legacy line, of your place of planting where God has intended you to be, amen? But no, ungodly ambition will take you out here. And that's fine if that's truly what you're called to. But you know what? More often than not, it's get in the, especially in this day and age, get in your planting, have that conviction, and get in the legacy path of those who have gone before, because this is kind of what she did. Beautiful. And godly ambition will always keep it pure. So always keep a pure heart before God. And it's like, Father, in Jesus' name, may my ambition be godly. Amen. And then eventually, like I said, the daughter ended up in the part of the field where God wanted her, and there was this collision. So, you know, just, oh, I love it. And the fourth thing I see here was that fame and courage, okay, was acknowledged. Reward and safety promised, all right? So Ruth 2. So Boaz, who is a picture of Jesus, our Redeemer kinsman, answered her, and he said, I've heard all about you. Fame, I've heard all about you. And he says, I've heard about the way you treated your mother-in-law. Isn't that interesting that her fame was attached to how she treated her mother-in-law? How she gave honor. Food for thought. He said, God rewards you well for what you have done. In verse 21, Ruth said, well, and she's talking to Naomi. She says, well, listen to this also. He told me, stick with my workers until my harvest is finished. Stick with my workers until my harvesting is finished. And Naomi looked at her and said, that's wonderful, dear daughter. Verse 22, that's wonderful. Do that. Do it. Good idea. Do it. And she says, and Naomi says, you'll be safe. Look at this, guys. Ladies, look at this. You'll be safe in the company of his young women. No danger of being raped in some stranger's field. And then in chapter 3, Boaz says, hey, everyone in town knows what a courageous woman you are, a real prize. So again, I love the storyline in here of how divine connection and promotion is God's domain. So just continue to be faithful with what is in your hand. And, you know, the promise is reward. And the instruction and the wisdom is to stick with the workers till the harvest is finished. Hallelujah. I'm talking kingdom harvest, people. I'm talking the days in which we live. And again, I love Mama Naomi's wisdom here. And she says to her daughter, she says, hey, do that. You'll be safe in the company of his women. Again, no danger of rape or defilement in a stranger's field. And I want to just pause here and be pastoral and say, can we never forget that the enemy's intent is to defile? And defile literally means to corrupt the purity or the perfection of something. To defile is to corrupt the purity or perfection of something. That is the enemy's intent. So, you know, just remember that. Keep that in mind, young people. 100 days of summer. Just remember this, young people, when you're tempted to flirt with the world. Because you might just think, I'm just flirting with the world. Well, yeah. But you need to know that there is an enemy out there and his intent is to defile you. And let's always remember that when we see the church, his beautiful church on the earth, attacked, because the enemy's intent is to defile the beauty and the perfection of her. And if this devil sought and yet failed, but sought to defile the Christ, he will certainly seek to defile the church. So carry the church with great affection. Talking to people who might be watching online today, treat the church with affection. Speak well of her. Be her advocate. Don't point out all her failings. There's centuries of failings. Hello. Talk with affection and love and be part of the answer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So lots and lots of kingdom lessons in there. So number one, no road, no journey. Second thought, real quick, is that if my journey could teach you anything, I would say that wasted strength and spent strength are different. Wasted and spent strength are different. What would waste strength? Very quickly, what would waste our strength? I think fighting the wrong battles wastes our strength, our precious strength. I think wasting energy on responses that take you nowhere, that achieve nothing, that bring no yield is wasted. Better to spend your strength, your energy on proactive things. Better. Do you know, Naomi had two daughters-in-law. I have two daughters-in-law. One is called Esther, one is called Lucille. They are both beautiful and I love them as my own daughter, Laura. I love them. You know, I love Esther. When I first met her, I fell in love with her. Okay, I was a little bit like, oh my gosh, Joel, who have you brought home? But, beautiful. But the second time I met her, literally, she was at our house. She'd come to our home. It was hilarious. Our children were all like, because their mouths were open because they'd never seen Joel looking after someone so beautifully. They were, I was just shutting their jaw, like, shut your jaw, shut your jaw, shut your jaw. And then, sorry. Anyway, but I then somehow, Brian and I somehow started to apologize for our failure, my failure, in sort of training my son in certain, you know, personal hygiene things. You know, because I mean, I tried when he was little, but then he grew up and they become their own person and it's like, okay, just be feral and disgusting, I don't care. But anyway, so I'm apologizing to my, you know, this girl, and she just looked at me, she was smiling, she goes, because I'm like here and she's there, she goes, it's all right, I'll take it from here. Gotta love that, right? And all the United boys went, yes, thank you, Jesus, there is a God in heaven. And then the other one is hilarious. She is a constant source of joy and hilarity, Lucille. She just makes up lines for our family. One line is, it's a family line, it's called hashtag awkward limbs. And it belongs to Brian. And because you know how he's, you can use it. You know how he's kind of gangly and like left-handed and just clumsy. And so, you know, that's the family hashtag. Hashtag awkward limbs. Okay, so anyway, these are my girls. But you know what, Lucille, a couple of weeks ago when they were still here, we came in from overseas and, you know, to be honest, they were, I could see exasperation in them because, you know, they had left Australia over the visa wait. And so they had left and gone and launched and da-da! And then it's like suddenly they're back in Australia, in the suburbs, in our back bedroom, five of them in our back bedroom waiting for this very long visa process. And I don't blame them for being exasperated or even marginally depressed. But anyway, so I could see this exasperation of energy and I went, sweetheart, look at me. There is nothing more than you can do. You have done everything. You have prayed and prayed and prayed. You've started the process. It's in the process. You can't do anything. Wasting this energy is accomplishing nothing except destroying you. So turn it around on something positive. At the same time, the same week, we had come in, it was Royal Commission Week, and I'm sorry that we have used this as an example a little bit, but you know, it was the same deal. I could see in my own life, I was talking to me, my family, those close, I was saying, do you know what? It is no point, any of us, wasting energy on how unfair this seems, not the issue, but the unfairness that yet again, my husband's integrity was about to be assailed. So there was no point in going, it is so not fair. It is so, it's like, there is, we don't have time for that. That is wasted energy. So we have to turn it around and we have to start to pray and take hold of God and actually address the spiritual things that we're attaching around the issue. I mean, the issue we were happy to have dealt with in our nation. It's going to make our nation better and stronger. So do you hear what I say? And that is true in all of our lives. We've got to wise up. In the heat of the battle, we can't implode. We're actually gonna rise up and get battle faith. And you can implode for 5 minutes and then you have to actually rise up and fire up and stand up in Jesus' name because otherwise you will be a casualty. Okay? Third thought, and I've only got a couple of minutes, is being spent. Being spent is not life-threatening. It is not life-threatening. It may look like it, feel like it, but it is not. It is actually, in Christ, it is actually occasion to experience the divine infusion of strength from above. When we are poured out in life, when we are poured out and at our end, He pours in. He pours in, but you know what? You have to recognize what is happening in you. And you have to wait. You have to wait, 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 wait. You have to wait. You know, there's Isaiah 40 says, it opens with these words, comfort, comfort my people. Comfort, comfort. Some of you in this room today, listening in the other locations, you know, online. Okay, the word of the Lord to you is comfort. Comfort, comfort. You're going through harsh times. You're going through troubled times. Comfort, comfort, my people, says God. Verse 29, it says he gives strength. He gives power. He gives power to the faint and the weary. He gives power. When you have no power, he gives it. Okay, it's not just little words on the paper. He gives power to the faint and the weary. And to him who has no might, he increases strength, causing it to multiply and making it to abound. Even youths shall faint and be weary. Really? What? Young and free? Even youth shall faint and be weary, and selected young men. This house is full of selected young men and women shall feebly stumble and fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord, who expect and look for and hope in him, shall change and renew their strength and power, and they will lift up their wings and they will mount up close to God as eagles mount up to the sun, and they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Let me quickly tell you four occasions where I have learned on the road that spent is not life-threatening, but rather an occasion to encounter the supreme and the brilliant and the all-perfect and powerful infusion of God. One has become like an altar moment. One was learnt in the field. One was learnt in the battle. And one was learnt watching my children. The one that is like an altar is the time that we recorded that song, With Everything, at the ASA. Do you remember that? With everything, that amazing song. And you know, for me, I'd come out of colour. And you know, I was spent, not in a bad way, but I was spent creatively. It was like, God, I don't know how it can get any better. God, I don't know how to keep telling this story. This story, God, I don't know how. And I was like sitting in the back of that auditorium, just singing with everything, with everything, with everything. And I'm telling you, that song became an altar. It is an altar where I did the exchange, where I went, Father God, I lay down my life, I put myself on the altar, and I wait for your genius and your ideas and your empowerment and enablement. When you're poured out, business people, career people, whatever, family, do you know what? There is a place, there is an altar where you go, God, with everything I've given, with everything. Another was learned on the field. Kala Kiev, at the end of a long colored hall, two conferences in Kiev, and it's hard because it's in Russian, it's double work. And conference one and conference two. Conference one ended at 5 o'clock at night. Conference two began at 7:30. Do you know, if you've ever run anything, do you know how huge that is? Had an hour to get back to the hotel. I walked into my hotel. I was like, Father, I can't do this. I am exhausted. I can't do this, God. So I got in the shower and I began to call on him, and I began to stir up every gift within me and every joyful thing. And I was like, hallelujah, I'm going to praise myself into this place. And as I stepped out of the shower, because you see, you can step into the shower going, I have nothing, God, I cannot do this. But if you dare to stop, stay in the shower, but get out of the shower and step into the fray. And it's like suddenly this infusion of strength. Well, we walked back and I went, I don't know what just happened, but let's do this like we've never done it before. One was learned in the battle recently, that Royal Commission week, and I woke up on that Friday morning before it, and church, I wasn't overwhelmed, but I have never felt so spiritually exposed, as if an enemy was surrounding us to defile us. I have never felt so exposed in my life. And I remember I didn't know what to do but wait. And so all day I waited. I went out. I did a manicure, a pedicure, and a massage because I wasn't ready to go back to my real world, which, gentlemen, that's what you do. FYI, learn from sisterhood. You have a mani, a pedi, and a massage, and it's like you'll all be better. And it's like, but I was like, God, help me. And I went home, and I just felt, I can't even begin to tell you, church, I make light of it, but it wasn't light. And at 4 o'clock in my bathroom, putting on my makeup to come to Friday night church, Sunday night meets Friday night, Encounter Fest here, I felt the infusion of God. I was like, I was one of those bent over rubbery things that are outside the car sales things, you know, those long, tall, skinny things. And I'm like, I was like that. And then all of a sudden, it just, breath of God. And then one was watch. Get the team with me. Come, team, please. And then one, and I share this one carefully, was watching my offspring, my children. You know, this Hollywood movie coming up in the Easter season. It is an open door that we have only walked through for one reason and one reason alone. That people will walk into a theatre and experience the presence of God. If you want to pray for it, pray to that end. And it is the story of Hillsong through the lens of Hillsong United. And I'm going to put a psych on the, an image on the screen, if I may, from the night. I actually wasn't there. I was in Texas. And I can't even begin to tell you the enormous pressure that has been on these boys. Just living already a huge life, managing and being away from family. And then the pressure to create and write and deliver and produce something astounding and within deadlines. I can't even begin to explain to you the pressure that they've actually been under. And I heard, because I wasn't there, I heard that there was a moment in the prayer meeting prior where selected young men stumbled and fell exhausted. In the prayer meeting, always a prayer meeting before they step out. See, we only see sometimes a stepping out. But behind the scenes, I heard that selected young men fell exhausted. And that certain selected young men wept in exhaustion. And that a certain young man was so spent and so empty that he put his head in his hands and sobbed and said, I have nothing more to give. I'm empty. I have nothing. And yet, this is where the divine exchange takes place. This is the place where the miraculous takes place. When our strength is zero, when our strength fails us, His does not. And in faith, because it's always in faith, my son, our sons and our daughters, they stepped out into that spotlight, which is for no other reason than to turn the spotlight on Him. And they drew on the unfailing, unending, immeasurable, perfect, and faithful strength of God. Why? So that others may know. Isaiah 40. Comfort, comfort, my people. In your life, comfort, comfort. If you're in a season, comfort, comfort. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. Shall walk and not faint. Comfort, comfort. You take heart today. You take heart in your Savior King. And you know what? If you're in a really good, happy, joyful, skipping along the road path place, awesome. Just tuck this up your sleeve. In case you need it one day, amen? Amen. Why don't we stand to our feet, church? Stand to our feet, hallelujah. I'm going to hand the service back to Darren, but you know, maybe, selected young man, can lead us, amen? And I'm going to let Darren take the end of the service, so don't go anywhere, okay? Do not leave. Not cool to leave right now. Okay, I love you, church.
Christ is enough for me. Christ.
don't we thank Pastor Bobby for a phenomenal word? Amazing. What about you? Man, how's your journey? Now, the truth of the matter is that God's got an awesome plan and an awesome purpose for your life. Now, the part of the journey, the part of the road where Jesus comes on the journey with you is available for every single person. I wonder if you'd join me in prayer. I want to pray for some people today. People who'd say, I've never given ownership of my life to the Lord Jesus Christ, but today I want to make a decision that I'm not going to walk my journey on my own, but that I'm going to walk my journey with Him. If you're here today and you've never made that decision, I'd love to include you in this prayer. If you're here today and you made that decision some time ago at some point, but the truth is right now, you're further away from God than you were when you first made that decision, I'd love to lead you in a prayer. It's a prayer that goes something like this. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. I ask you to come into my life. I want to ask you to forgive me for everything that I've done wrong. And I want to give you ownership of my life from this day forward. If you're here today, you've never prayed a prayer like that, and you'd like to say, Darren, when you pray that prayer, I want to be included in that prayer. I'd love to include you in the prayer. If you're here and you prayed that prayer once before, but you're saying, I'm off track. You know, I was on this journey, but the truth is right now, I'm out here somewhere and I need to get back with God's plan and purpose for my life. Just with every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to ask you I want to include you in that prayer. So if you'd say, Darren, I want to be included in that prayer. I'm going to pray that prayer. I'm going to count to three. When I get to three, I'm going to ask you to lift your hand up. I'm going to acknowledge that you've got your hand in the air. I'm going to ask you to put it back down and pray for you right where you're at. Are you ready? Either in other campuses or online or right here in our Hills campus, if you're here and you'd say, Darren, I want to pray that prayer. I want to invite Jesus in as Lord of my life. Are you ready? One, two, three. Just lift it up. Awesome. Good on you. Fantastic. We're going to be praying for every person. Last chance. I don't want to prolong this, but if you're here and you say, hey, I want to be included, just slip up your hand. Why don't we all pray this prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. I ask you to come into my life as my Lord and my Savior. I ask you to forgive me for everything that I've done wrong. And I repent of those things. I want to live for you, Lord. From this day forward, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Why don't we congratulate those people? We would love to bless you, to help you on the journey. If you lifted your hand, someone may have seen you and will slip in beside you, give you this Bible. You know, the thing is, if you didn't lift your hand, I mean, lifting your hand so that I know and so that I can pray for you, but praying the prayer is just so God knows. And if you didn't lift your hand so no one saw you, there's going to be some people in the foyers as well, and they're going to be standing here like this with the Bible about so high. They're kind of standing there awkwardly with the Bible in the foyer just to help you take the next step. So why don't you just stand in next to them and say, hey, I prayed that prayer. I'd love to grab one of those Bibles and they'd love to help you with that, all right? You ready for the rest of the day? Don't forget tonight, we have got the Reverend Dr. Christopher Mendez, who's going to be preaching the word. Man of faith always comes ready. Dios te bendiga, Espíritu Santo, en el nombre de Jesús. Gloria a Dios. I can speak fluent Christian Spanish. All right, before you go, let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for every single person here. Lord, put in your first today. Lord, I pray that you would bless them. Lord, you would keep them. Lord, you would cause your face to shine upon them. Lord, I pray that as they go about their day or as they go about their week, Lord, that they would understand that they are carrying a mandate, Lord, that they are being your light in darkness, that they are being the salt to the earth, Lord. And I pray you bless them and cause them to prosper in everything they do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Have a great day. See you tonight.